It is a pleasure to introduce tonight's lecturer, Jonathan Levi. He has been an important presence for me personally during the course of all the years I have taught at the GSD. Few architects I have known are as dedicated as he is to extending the legacy of modern architecture while at the same time recognizing the tensions between conflicting values. On the one hand, the conventions that govern common tastes and economically motivated developments, and on the other hand, the present-day evolution of 20th century architectural aesthetic and social values that he holds so high, which for the most part, as I have seen it, were inspired by very important iconic architectural figures, including, I'll just name two, great ones, obviously, Frank Lloyd Wright and Louis Kahn, but also by many of his teachers and mentors, and he has been one for us, and I will mention two of his, Thomas Beebe and Michael McKinnell. During a period dominated by cartoonish and atectonic historicist postmodernism, Jonathan remained a stalwart late modernist in an environment not always friendly to his cause. He is rare in his ability to bridge the divide that I spoke of and to reconsider visionary architectural ideas with connection to contemporary issues. Until a few years ago, Jonathan's practice was most known for several highly refined small-scale projects, houses and small institutional buildings, and in these, innovations of some very significant elements. He invented very interesting windows, interior built-in furnishings, and really created his own language. Later, his practice focused on important issues that are generally neglected by architects in the academy, particularly, including community buildings and schools. There are many in the area you should see if you haven't already. He mastered the art, or he always has, I think, of gaining the trust of the client and constituency groups to achieve balance within the neighborhoods of his projects while retaining the tectonic language he has for so long been dedicated to teaching and developing in his own work. In another significant shift in his practice more recently, he has redirected his emphasis to the design, from the design of individual buildings to large-scale housing developments and several abroad. Among other honors, his firm, Jonathan Levi Architects, has won 16 awards for design excellence from the Boston Society of Architects, including two Halston Parker medals for the best project of a building type built in the metropolitan area. Other awards include the Grand Prize Design Award in the 21st Century Project Competition of the Association of College and University Housing Officers for a speculative dormitory, very significant and interesting project in its own right. There are many such individual awards that he has won. I would not, cannot, and should not name all of them, but to give you a sense, they go into very particular areas. I would just like to also add how significant and important a teacher and how rigorous a teacher he is, how important his pedagogical ideas have been in the school. He has always brought to the students' attention their role and helped them to define their mission within the field. His attention to materials and details in buildings helps the students to complete their projects in a higher level than many other professors, and brings a thorough understanding of structure into the discussion as well. His construction and materials course, I'll mention one course, the one we all know so well, City of Wood, has really been a fixture in the curriculum and is in itself a kind of legacy of his achievements and contribution about expanding the role of architects in building the American city and suburbs. Finally, I would just say that he is really one of the most important champions of the profession and consistently illuminates the challenges of contemporary practice. His emphasis on the importance of establishing a consensus building approach and a leadership role for the architect in the American context in particular, distinguishes him. he recommends an approach involving new, emerging collaborative modes of practice. This would replace those persistent tensions that he knows so much about between divergent values, as I mentioned earlier, and bring together people into a new collaborative configuration that we would welcome. And with that, I would like to welcome him. Jonathan, thank you so much for giving us this lecture tonight. You can take questions afterwards.
Thank you, Scott. Well, my remarks tonight are going to be divided into two parts. One, a reflection on the status of architecture as I know it today, which I think is worth doing from the meditations and the travails of a practicing architect, primarily, also as a teacher. And then secondly, I'd like to tell you something about the future and where I think we're headed and where I think we ought to be directing our attention as architects and as a project of architecture. But first, I'd like to take this attention to this occasion to reflect a little on the influences that I've had here at the school. It's a good time to do that and to acknowledge and to thank several people. And also in doing that, you'll learn a little about the ideological context that I function in and the roots that have been really flourished in the work that I've done, but rooted in the ideas of other people. First, Scott, I feel warmth. I feel joy. When I see you around the school, it makes me so happy. I'll tell you why. Because you make everyone's life difficult. No one is safe near you. To live with you is to live with a constant provocation. I don't know how anybody could do it in their personal life, but in our school life, I understand the wisdom of Jorge and others in having you take on the mantle of the school. And it has been a challenge to me, and you've constantly provoked me to be more articulate and also to defend my status as a modern architect. Once you called me a modern architect, and it was no doubt meant as an insult, and one of the things I'm here today to do is to defend modern architecture. I would actually even question if we're in a period that's anything other than modern, but I'd like to tell you more about what I think modern architecture is. And then the list. Vincent Scully, who was my mentor and teacher at Yale as an undergraduate, and whose primary contribution to me was identifying the American problem as one of the conflict between a wild lust for individuality and the need to come together into cities and settlements. And he did that primarily by identifying the American house as our architectural project, which is hard for people visiting here to understand. The hollowness and the emptiness of buildings like cathedrals and even courthouses, that they really don't match the immediacy and the poignancy of the residential house, primarily the single-family house, as a expression of our soul, as a culture. Vincent Scully, of course, championed the house, and his greatest, and to my, I think really by far his greatest work, the shingle and stick style, told us that story in a way that's still very relevant today. Second, Harry Cobb, for hiring me. against my better judgment to teach at the time. It proved, in the context of what is really the bitter antipathy to which anything new or innovative is treated by the public, to be the only course which would have sustained my practice. There would have been no way for me to take the steps that I took in my practice without having an anchor here at the school. So thanks to Harry for that. To Raphael, the provocation that really began this series of inquiries, I'll tell you a story. So Raphael was a very proactive chair, meaning he had probably had a lot of time to spend when he was here. And he would roam around the school. He would stand behind you. You'd be giving a desk crit, and it'd be one-on-one, and you'd be talking to the student, and you'd look around, and there's Raphael, like right there, standing over your shoulder, and he said, "Oh, continue. You know, go ahead." So he was very active, and he wanted to know what I was going to teach in the technology course that he had assigned. And I said, well, I'm going to try to alert students to the importance of technology and how it's impossible to consider even the largest cultural project without understanding technology. And he said, you're not going to teach anything about wood, are you? I said, yeah, I was thinking of that because most of these students are going to be making wood buildings. He said, it's inferior. Don't bother with that. Teach them about steel and masonry, but don't teach them about wood. This is a true story. So that got me thinking. Mac, who's here today, and I've told him this many, many times, and I never give up the opportunity to remind him that his example in doing that series of public library projects has been my inspiration for my practice. These were projects for ordinary people in an ordinary place. How we got them built is totally beyond me. But I think it's an example and one of the very rare examples of an architect working at the very outer edge of beauty and perfection for ordinary people. And what did he say when he walked into that library committee room? What did he say to them? You know, I asked myself that question many times and tried to imagine and replicate whatever it was that he said. Jorge, who, if you don't understand this and know it as I do, having been here at the school since 1976, is the reason the school is what it is. It was his, well, Jerry asked him to come, but Jorge implemented. And the academic and intellectual culture that we all enjoy today was created by him. So I thank him for that. Also, I have a more detailed acknowledgement, which is his focus and emphasis on housing, which is the modernist project, no doubt. Why it's the modernist project is very interesting, and I'll talk to you about that a little later. But let's remember that at the time that he started teaching housing in the South End, it was a very broken place with many empty spaces. And we went there. He would take us all there to his studio, and we would look at those broken and empty places. Well, where are we today? No, really. That is an example of theory preceding actuality, because he imagined that those places would someday be filled. And he imagined that there would have to be an attitude and an approach to how to do that, and that's what we worked on for many years in the studio setting with the students. I also noticed that Bill's here today, and I need to acknowledge Bill because he has been, well, actually our practices are about the same age, so to call him a mentor isn't really, well, I suppose I should anyways. The reason is because Bill has an amazing control and insight of what into what makes people tick and what makes institutions tick. And that's something that I've tried to learn from him very imperfectly. But it remains a really very important example. We hear about the excellence of his practice, but really what it is his ability to identify with and empathize with the way mental processes work in other people and the way social processes work in institutions, like colleges and universities especially. And then finally, Tom Beebe, who Scott preempted me earlier. Actually, you preempted my whole lecture earlier, but I'll continue anyways. Tom, who most of you won't know, but he is the former dean of Yale, and I spent the first 4 years of my professional life with him. What did I learn from him? Well, the most important thing, perfect devotion to the needs of the client without compromising art or reason. That's what Tom taught me. And he is a superlative artist. But what an amazing thing, because it didn't seem to me important what the client thought or needed. And it seemed to me like it was a very slippery slope to be thinking about that and then trying to hold one's own artistic integrity intact. But somehow he told me that whatever happened, my understanding of that need was more important. And he didn't mean it in the sense of, oh, they're going to tell you to make a square, make a square. I mean, he didn't mean that. He meant really driving to the inner purposes of the so-called client or institution or person that was in front of you. And in unlocking that inner purpose, providing a revelation to oneself and to the client, which happened many times that I witnessed in front of him. And also his tools and technique for doing that is something that I studied carefully. And it can be iterated and taught, and I've tried to do that in my studios. And then one other thing about Tom that people don't understand, because they associate him with postmodernism, is that he was an authentic, and is an authentic second-generation apostle of Mies. There was only one step between him and Mies. And that rigor was everywhere present in that office. And even the small and inexact replication that I've tried to pull off in my own work, even that is enough to propel me forward and also to be called by others as somebody rigorous. But no, I'm not rigorous in the terms of that culture of technology and materiality, which I'll talk about in a moment. So the themes of my teaching, I just wanted to mention briefly, and I'll be touching on all of these within the short time that we have together. Would you give me, somebody give me a nod, maybe somewhere around, I can easily talk for 3 hours, so if you can give me a nod somewhere around quarter of eight, that would be very helpful. Composition, it's a very strange thing to start with. I think most would think materiality and social agency and practice, those are the other three. But I mention composition because to me, composition is about intelligibility. It's about art, but it's also about intelligibility and language. And I think intelligibility is a critical bridge to a new era of effectiveness that architects might have. So intelligibility through composition. So I think of myself as a person who teaches composition. And I ask myself, my students to be deliberate about composition in the sense that it's about intention and the marriage of intention and formal concerns. So intention can be inward and solipsistic, but it also needs to be intention, needs to be ascertainable and understandable to somebody else. So it's trying to create that bridge between intention and the ability of others to understand it that I consider to be composition. And I ask students to tell me about it, and let's think about it. It's almost psychological talking about it. Tell me about your composition. What did you choose to do where? So those are the themes. Let me move forward now into the lecture. So this lecture is about keeping one's eye on the ball. And the first ball and the most important ball is we're also overwhelmed by the question of sprawl and the size of cities, and we live in dense places. But I think the ball that we have to keep in mind is that the country is really undeveloped. Only 5% of the land area of the country that we live in is developed, is occupied. The other 95% is unoccupied. There are other parts of the world that are like this, but not the ones that we typically think about a lot. And it's important to realize that there's a huge project awaiting us, right out in front of us. 95% is farmland or forest. Most of it's forest. Forest and wilderness. So the wilderness is still with us. It's not something we put away 200 years ago. It's something that's very present that we're grappling with and we need to work with. And here you can see, I apologize for these funky graphics, but this is the way it comes from the U.S. government. You can see even where we are in this supposedly very dense, well-occupied part of the country, half of the state is unoccupied. So you can see that when you fly into Boston and you look, especially at night, and see where the lights are. It's mostly black down there. So there's a lot of work to be done, and we would like to be a part of it. That's the ball that I'm talking about. Also, we're in the midst of a revolution, and I don't believe that I'm overstating that. There was a revolution when I was younger. It was about social activism. It was about restating the relationship between people and the relationship between people and culture. The revolution that we're in now isn't based in social activism. It's based in commerce, and it's based in technology, things that we're not really controlling or directing. We have to be aware of it, and I'm going to try to identify for you what I think the major portions of that revolution are that affect architecture itself and affect it very dramatically. Finally, there are times and places when architects need to focus on one another and what we do internally. I remember Raphael was very clear about that, and that's one of the ingredients of the intellectual ferment that we live in today here at the school. But we need to keep in mind that architecture, the excellence of architecture, what it can give, needs to be evenly spread, in my view. Even. That means that we are all equal and that every place at every time in the day is equal. In other words, deserves the same magnitude of intention and excellence. Not one place, little nodes of excellence, and then the rest is suffering, but even. So that's one thing. And then also, utilization, that the built landscape should be evenly utilized, not portions of it that are well utilized and other portions that are not. If this is the primary directive of ecology, if we're talking about ecology, which is that we don't build if we don't have to. So if we build, we need to build intensively, with purpose, with functional intensity, but also with spiritual intensity. And I think there are vast areas of the country that are built, but that are not occupied or utilized. And I'll tell you more about that in a minute. About 50 years ago, no, it's almost 60 years ago, there was a young immigrant woman who was recently married. She moved into this neighborhood, just a few streets down Broadway, and she just had a child. And the child was a problem because the woman had to work. It was not like today when everyone works, but at that time, few women worked, so it was an unusual situation. She looked in the paper and she saw an ad for a job at Robinson Hall, which is around the corner here. And she answered it, bringing the baby with her, less than 1 year old. And the kindly man said, yes, you can work. I need a personal stenographer, and I'm dictating my papers, and please come here and work. And she said, well, I have a problem. I have this baby. He said, bring the baby. And for the 2 years that this woman worked for that elderly gentleman, the baby played on the floor all day long. It's an amazing story. The gentleman was Walter Gropius, and the baby was me. And I mention that, true story, and I mention that because I have grown up being indoctrinated about Harvard and the functionalist impersonality of our school, coming from Yale and going through all, and this was, is that every time I go to Yale, Bob Stern confronts me and says, are you still teaching there? That awful place where people are mean. And I just like to remind you that this is actually a place of social relevance. Gropius was acting on his beliefs. He was a social revolutionary. And functionalism isn't something cold or detached. Functionalism is social activism. That's what he meant by functionalism. He meant healing the wounds that were caused by industrialization through something that we could give, through design. So this is the theme of my lecture. I believe that modernism is not a way of looking or seeing or visualizing or making form. I believe that modernism is a social project, and it's ongoing, and it should be ongoing. I think we're in a moment where students are experiencing something of a crisis of values. And I want to remind them that in between the serving of indigent populations in Haiti or New Orleans and the internal speculation about formalism, there's something else in between that has to do with social relevance in our own communities. This is my point, and why I tell you about Gropius. And of course, he did do this. This is a school project. He did many school projects in Massachusetts. This is what he was interested in before his organization became a juggernaut with its own means and purposes. But he was doing schools, very interested in schools, and others like him were doing schools. This one's in Attleboro. And just a reminder for those, maybe this is taught well in history, buildings, texts, and context, but so much of modernism was about addressing directly tangible problems that were caused by industrialization. So they were about health, and they were about housing, and they were about education. This is what the projects were. This was the foundation and the formation, Alto Sanatorium, and the canonical Wiesenhof, which is a housing project, a very important and modest one. Also, at that point in, this is a little earlier, there was an incredible interest in the mode of American living and the question of comfort and how it could be served, a new level of comfort. I think it's very important to understand Wright as an author of a way of life, as a way of making people more comfortable. And when he sought very actively to publish, not in professional magazines, but in lay journals, like Ladies' Home Journal, which is an illustration from, and to depict a way of life in those illustrations. And I think there was also a point in mid-20th century architecture and where there was a far greater interest in interiors than there is today, which I think is a very profound defect in the way that we're approaching architecture now. Interiority. Why are buildings there? They're there to make interiors for people to take comfort in. So the difference between interior and architecture and exterior architecture, I think, is something that we need to meditate on and consider, because our modernism, one prong of it, has been so focused on erasing the difference between the inside and the outside, yet the difference is profound and important. Comfort. So I mentioned briefly this question of indigence and working on the social project. The students know. They're worried about it. They're concerned about it. This is New Orleans, Brad Pitt in New Orleans. They're concerned about it. But I just want them to understand. Well, let me see if I can express this properly. It's like the difference between a hospital and a school of public health. A hospital is dealing with acute illness. They're dealing with momentary intensities of crisis in health. Yet, if we take the total measure of suffering, what portion of it is attributable to crisis, and what portion of it is attributable to the general suffering that we all encounter in our everyday lives? I think the project that we have at hand is not the minute suffering that occurs in moments that are very explicit and exposed, but more in the suffering that's underneath the surface, that's hidden, and that is harder to reach and to get at. And just as one way of illustrating that, just looking at mental health, the World Health Organization tells us that half the world is suffering from mental health disorder. Half the world. I think that the boundary between consciousness and the environment is a very fragile, narrow boundary. The way we think, the way we cognate, the way we experience is not very different from the places where we are. So this question of suffering is far more spread out than the students imagine. And so I think that's just a little Band-Aid on our conscience about self-actualization in the form of social activism. We need a far more deliberate and far more systematic and dedicated approach to social intervention. One other way of looking at that, a writer who has been profoundly influential for me, because he has described an area of sociology that is so directly relevant to architecture, yet nobody has yet made the connection, reaching out the hand to him and to that school to understand how critical what we do is to what he has defined as a national problem and as a mechanism which underlies everything that we tend to talk about in architecture in terms of the formation of community in the city. That would be Robert Putnam, the former dean at the Kennedy School of Government, who has defined a phenomenon which he names social capital. Unfortunate term in my view. Essentially, he's pandering to the quantification of people who like to put numbers to things, and economics is the way that governments activate themselves and motivate themselves. But so he chose the word capital to describe it. But he's saying that the way that we relate to one another is a resource, and that if the resource is depressed, there are dire consequences in terms of productivity and the national project. And this is one of the charts from his very interesting and important book, which is an interesting companion to postmodernism, I think. Bowling Alone, which many of you will know, and the students at some different points have been very fond of this book. This describes what's happening in terms of political engagement, civil engagement, but there are many charts like this that describe the inability of individuals to coalesce into productive social units. Productive is the operant word. And I've also thought a lot about this given the work that I've done in higher education and creating places for people to come together around ideas, and how communities of knowledge and speculation are created in places like ours, the Harvard University. This is a map that describes the relationship between housing, research, culture, and student life at the one around Washington Square in New York. NYU, thank you. New York University, thank you. But the conjoining of, this map is very different at different universities, very, very different, with very different results. Many universities are faultily constructed on the concept that students commute from the periphery to the center. Bad idea, especially today when so much instruction is increasingly web-based. This is about physical space, is what I'm saying. I'm trying to draw a connection between physical space, social capital, and social activism among architects and the importance of what we do. So a few words on the question of how social agency is achieved by architects. No doubt, one of the important things that we think about here at the school is how ideas move around among architects and between eras of architecture. Here you can see, maybe this is new to some of you, Thomas Jefferson on the right, on the left, and Lou Kahn on the right. It's clear that Jefferson influenced Kahn. I think that's very important for us to understand the way ideas move between us. But more important, and we all know the famous graph that attempts to map out the connections between us, but more important is the way ideas actually impact everyday life. And I think that flow of ideas from here, this school, and the advanced practices that it represents, to ordinary people can be charted. You can actually look at it and see the cause and effect as you move forward. I'll give you some simple examples. Randomization, which, by the way, I think is probably 40 or 50 years from now, people will look back at our time, and I think probably the most characteristic thing that you can say about it is this type of architecture. But here it is, moving from Korb in the first seminal moment, I think, if somebody else can find an earlier one, I'm willing to listen to it, to Harry Weiss and others. There were others in that period of time who were influenced. And then finally, an echo. And really, this is the first time I remember seeing this when Raphael showed this project, even when it was before it was completed, and thinking, I've seen that before, but it's new at the same time. And then finally, everywhere, this is East Cambridge, everywhere. So clearly there is a genealogy of an idea, and one wonders if the architects in the first instance are considering the mode of conduct through to the final point of proliferation, if there would be a way of planning for that. I believe that people like Gropius and others who I even respect more, and I'll show you a little bit about that in a minute in the example of Mies, I believe that they charted that. They understood. They invented to proliferate. That was their purpose. That's another defining characteristic of modernism that I think is a lesson for us today. And here are some others. Another obscure, maybe, example, a very important one. This is the Auburndale Railroad Station by Richardson, which I actually went to as a child every day to pick up my dad. But look at what it has that nobody else has, a low-hipped roof. Does that remind you of anything? And we know that Wright was poring over the drawings of Richardson and deeply influenced by all of his publications. The railroad stations were heavily published. And how important an invention that was, the low-hipped roof, for all the reasons that we know today, that it expressed a moment in the American landscape, that it was economical, that it did away with the attic, all the reasons that you've heard before. And the Ur architect, Palladio, of course, this is the canonical example of influence. Villaimo, of course, Jefferson, through the agency of Jefferson, and finally, we think of ourselves like this, mostly because of Jefferson, but people don't understand that Palladio stands behind Jefferson. I mean, lay people. So this deliberateness of influence. Listen, we all adore Mies. We like him because he does so many things so well. I adore Mies because I'm a technological determinist, and I'll tell you more about technological determinism in a moment. But the reason most people like him is because of what we call minimalism, which isn't really right. It is not minimal. I have never thought of Mies that way. Think of the invention. He comes here. He looks around. He sees steel, a lot of steel. He sees the aftermath of World War II, the rise of American corporations. He takes the material at hand, and he makes a new language and instantly explodes into new cities. What an amazing achievement. I don't think that's ever happened before. It's happened much slower. It's happened before, but much slower. He intended it. He had a word for it, factuality. He was theorizing about it in the 20s and 30s, and then he came here and he executed. So what a profound development, and what a profound demonstration of the identity between materiality and architecture and the city. An identity. You cannot tell me that he wanted to make cubes like this. He didn't want to make cubes like this. He wanted to make a frame that was readily available. And oh, by the way, it's a lot less expensive than everything else that you're doing, which is very important, and he understood that. And the second generation, this is Skidmore at Inland Steel, and the third generation, and the thousands and hundreds of thousands of buildings like this one's in New Haven that are like this, that are the progeny, direct progeny of an architect who intended to father thousands. So I'm thinking also about wood, and I want to bring you back to a moment in history when there was a connection between contemporary architecture and lay public. And it's a moment that I think, well, at least for me, got skipped over too quickly. It was a moment of abstraction, it was a moment of materiality, and it was also a moment of connection with the soul of the country, which I think, in the poetic metaphor that I am using tonight, is wood. This is Sea Ranch. And at the same, very, very same time, there was also Edward Larry B. Barnes at Haystack. These are really interesting projects. They are deeply relevant to what we are thinking about today in terms of abstraction. And also, they're very buildable. They really relate to not just materiality, but a culture of materiality, a key distinction that I'd like to make. The difference between materiality, which we sometimes involve ourselves with here at the school, thinking that a lump of stone is something to fashion, but not understanding that in architecture, materials are only valuable insofar as they're embedded in a giant culture of materiality, of process, of industrialization, of representation. So this was a key moment, and it worked very well. Unfortunately, it was supplanted by postmodernism very rapidly. But it had many progeny. And the moment that I'm referring to is the moment when you could go to a subdivision in Weston or Framingham, and you could look at that book that they were offering you, and half the pages were traditional buildings, and the other half were contemporary. You could pick a contemporary building to build. There were people who considered that to be the right and perfect way of making a home for themselves. So I'm very interested in this kind of architecture, this kind of history. And I think I'm not an historian, but it's a message that I have for the school. I think there's a missing category of history. And it's very similar to the kind of German history that was being done in the 80s called microhistory, where people are looking at the everyday life of political, small bodies of political bodies, not at the larger scale, but at the tiny scale. I think we need a history like that. Because if we had it, and we could start to articulate the steps that occur in between the seminal moment and the moment of dissemination, we could make for a better throughput to that moment of dissemination, not one that was just about adulteration and watering down. In the case of Mies, by the way, many great, important buildings were produced in that third generation, many very mediocre ones, but the language was so strong and so powerful and so cohesive that it was able to produce excellence, an argument that you've heard from postmoderns as well, I'm sure. So this is one of my favorites from my own youth growing up, but it's a similar kind of a history. It's a history that just knocks the head off of the shape of humanity and just looks at the body and the legs, no head. So just another image that I just wanted to share with you because I think it's so interesting. There was an architect here in Boston, and this is a catalog page to show you how early this goes back, this commingling of contemporary and traditional. This is an architect named Royalberry Wills, who is our equivalent of, some of you will know, David Adler or Howard Van Doren Shaw or Edwin Lutyens. This is Boston's version of that, and some of it is very, very good. His catalog was divided into two parts, traditional architecture and contemporary. The contemporary was all done by Stubbins, Hugh Stubbins, who worked in his office at the time. What's interesting about that is this is 1940. It's only 15 years after Pessac and what's happening in Europe. So a very rapid introduction of this contemporary language into the vernacular of local production. And there were many buildings like this. I'm interested in this kind of architecture, the architecture that flows from the great idea immediately to the point of application. what a former dean of the school called actionable knowledge. How do you make knowledge that is easily actionable? This is the progeny of Gropius. This is Carl Koch. And there are a series of companies like his that was spawned directly from Gropius's ideas. They made houses for ordinary people that were excellent. They were based on wood. There were acorn houses and deck houses and tech-built houses, all of them students of Walter Gropius, all of them asserting the role and importance of contemporary architecture for ordinary people, and many, many of these were built throughout New England and also throughout other parts of the country. This example actually is from North Carolina. And also you can see the interiors and how beautiful they are. Considering the problem of the material systems that create wood architecture, and they were very interested in getting away from stick-built architecture, which is what we have to do today, in my view. This is where we are today. So if you look at a contemporary manual of production housing, you are not going to find contemporary examples. There are none, zero. And they're easy to find because the catalogs are easy to find because there are only three or four manufacturers of large tract housing in the country today. It's all been consolidated in the last 10 years. None of these people believe that contemporary architecture has a role to play. A lot of it is the missteps that we ourselves made. More important to me than postmodernism, than the shapes of it, when I was born as a young architect, was this book, which planted a seed of tremendous doubt and question. Does everyone know this book? It's called Pesach Revisited. A scholar went to Pesach, which was the first mass housing project that was executed by Le Corbusier based on some of the principles that were developed in exhibits that he had created and drawings. And then he revisited them in the early 70s and produced this book. So, you can blame the people, but you know, in my heart of hearts, having grown up with a liberal political background, how long can you blame the people? I mean, if an idea is not perceived as being worthy, how worthy can it be? And this is the thought that advises me every time I walk into a school committee room or into a town council and advocate for an idea. To me, if I can't introduce something of importance with that group, these are intelligent people. They're lawyers, they're doctors, they're people with the same education as I. If I cannot advocate an architecture that's important to them, it can't be important. I think this is the question that we have to keep throwing ourselves up against. And this is the origin of it for me, this wonderful book. And you think about the different things that people did and why. I go back to this book and think about why. What was it about this that was so totally unsatisfactory? To me, that looks great. Why do they need to put piping all around all the edges? Why do they need to enclose the balcony on the top? Why do they need to enclose this outdoor porch? Such an important concept in the repertoire of Le Corbusier, the open outdoor terrace, always enclosed. And why is architecture, contemporary architecture, held in such poor ill repute? I always look to the movies to tell me. I'm trying always to understand what it is that ordinary people are thinking. It's so interesting to me. I love James Bond films. When you go to James Bond films, whether they're in the mid-60s or in today's time, you go and see where he lives. This is Dr. No, and you can see where he lives. It's all traditional. There's bric-a-brac, and there's Louis the 15th chair, and it's all traditional. And then you go to the Nemesis, and it's always contemporary modern architecture. Why is that? And it's not just here. These are international films. So I think we need to keep trying. That's essentially what I'm asking of myself and of you. We need to keep trying, not shying away, not retreating, not moving back in a way, but keep moving forward into the bosom of mass culture to understand how we can make a better connection. This is how I did it in the early part of our career. This was the height of postmodernism. I was trying to explain to my students what postmodernism was. There was a day in a studio that I was taking here when a student came with a symmetrical plan. This was in 1976. Maybe it was even Jorge's studio. I don't remember. It was a total outrage. That student was thought of as an idiot, that he could do a symmetrical plan. So I'm just telling you, it seems trivial today, and probably it ought to be, because the results have been so terrible for architecture and the countryside. But at that time, it was the most radical thing you could think of, to make buildings that connected with people. We learned that you just can't do that. You can't do it simply. It's not easy to do. So this was a developer housing project where we made different types, and they looked like that. There's a story to this. The story is that, oh, look at those buildings. Fairly innocuous, nothing radical there. I was making changes. I was trying to make a better plan. It was centric. I had a problem of a site without any trees, so I had need to make objects that really could hold their own in the landscape. These houses would not sell. 16 houses that poor fellow built based on my design. Very fine increments of meaning made the difference. And I've done my own Pesach revisited and gone back and looked, and it's really amazing to see what people have done. They didn't like that big chimney. They cut it off. They enclosed the open spaces just like they did at Pesach. Wherever I left an open porch or something recess, they papered it over and made more living space for themselves. It's a question of identity. This is at the beginning of one of our school projects. We asked, actually the school principal in a brilliant move, asked the students to make a drawing of the new school, design a new school. And we got back 40 or 50 of these 11 by 17 sketches from the students. And this one, well, aside from the fact that the student is really ingenious about what is important. You know, you need rooms for the history of the plains and ocean, and there has to be a Six Flags amusement park, and all these other things that they included. But the thing that amazed me, and I love to read Freud, the thing that amazed me, look what they drew. Does anybody recognize that? It's a person. I don't think the child knew that they were drawing a person. They did it anyway because the child needs to identify. There is a identity between person and environment, between person and building, that my buyers in Sutton, Mass. At this project did not have. They could not identify with what I had created for them. Here's the school. So schoolwork, listen, it's very hard to do housing. You're working with developers, and I don't like architects who impugn the integrity or the ethics of their clients. I think that's a terrible thing to do and hypocritical. But developers are difficult to work with because they have their ear to the ground constantly, and they want to make judgments that reduce their risk. So very hard. But you can reach the people through schools. And that's one of the things that I found was an opportunity, an opening for modern architecture to come in. It just so happens that the school building project in our country is huge. The entire inventory was built in a space of 10 years in, after World War II, and it's all falling apart. So it needs to be replaced or repaired. Most of it's being replaced. So it's a huge project. And I can tell you, there are almost no architects who you or I consider to be careful, thoughtful designers involved in this project. It's a multi-billion dollar project that is unfolding over a short period of time. So we've become involved in schools, not because it was a business opportunity, but because there are many buildings to build. And they give an insight into the point of contact between ideology and popular culture. And they also do that through the lens of the child. And I think it's so interesting when you go to a school to work on a school, it's immediately on a different moral plane than doing a workplace. Oh, they're just adults, they can do with. Or it's housing, and we'll talk about housing in a minute. You know, people aren't that concerned. As long as they have the amount of floor area school, people are very concerned. We ought to treat ourselves more like children, to tell you the truth. It's one of the things that I've learned from doing schools, is the sensitivity to one another is just not there in terms of the sense of well-being that's being created. This is the school. A large part of the work that we do in schools is around daylight. I think daylight is, it's not written into our codes. Who knows why? It should be. Daylight is like food. There are so many empirical proofs of the importance of daylight to well-being. This question of social capital, a lot of it has to do with daylight, bringing together people in daylight. So we work a lot on it. And you can see also we work on the places. Remember the equation that I showed you earlier. If I'm distributing my level of effort in a school, I look at where the people are and where they spend their time. And I've noticed in publications of schools that there's almost never a picture of a classroom or a tiny picture inset in the little corner there with drop ceiling and fluorescent light and so on. We lavished all of our attention here on the school classroom because that's where the students are. Also, it's ecological to think about daylight because it's available, it's free. Most of the cost of running a building, which people are very concerned about for children in daylight hours, is in a poorly designed school, the cost of running the lights. So a note on materiality, and I've talked about it earlier. This is Mies again. I'm a material determinist, meaning that it comes first. Without the material agency or possibility, nothing else is possible. So one of the important explanations for modernism that comes before even the social project is the advent of the material. In this case, glass and steel. Glass and steel, it's a game changer. It means an entirely new type of architecture. This is Tugendhat House, as many of you know. But it was always the case. This is a drawing that I had my students build by hand when I first started teaching housing. It's a drawing of the South End that we were just talking about. And they did another drawing just like this, which was a framing plan of the entire neighborhood. This unit of aggregation, the scale, the size of the buildings, and the way they relate to one another, it's based on a 2x10. It's because a 2x10 spans a certain distance, and a 2x10 is based on the practical process of getting lumber out of a tree. That's the right size. Not too small and not too large. So we see a pattern, even at the city scale, of materiality, of use and of social aggregation based on materiality. That's why I'm so interested in it as a way of thinking about architecture. And this is really why the project that I've described, which is about social agency, is called the City of Wood, because it is wood that governs who we are and what is possible where we are. And I'll tell you about that in a minute. This is Mies again. The national character. So I'm engaged, now we're going to talk a little bit about the cities of wood. I'm engaged in a project in my office, as time allows, in speculating about how we should live. I want to know where we came from, and I want to know where we're going. As I said earlier, this is a moment of enormous opportunity and change. Something dramatic is happening all around us right now that calls into question the very existence of the cities that we occupy and their shape. I know that sounds dramatic. It is dramatic, but I think it's true. And I'll tell you why, and I'll try to give you a proof as to why. Where did we come from? The big problem here is that we don't like cities as a people. We really don't. We would rather be individuals. This is based in political philosophy. I've been reading the history of the 18th century recently. Thomas Jefferson didn't want a federal government. He thought that the country was going to consist of farmers out in the country doing their individual own thing and barely coming together when they had to resist the influence of outside countries, foreign countries. The whole early part of the country was a very precarious battle between people who thought of civilization as something about people coming together and others who were libertarian. Basically, Jefferson was a libertarian. He was like the guy up in the shack, wood shack in Montana. That's what Thomas Jefferson was. And it's a very important undercurrent of our civilization. Some people think that it's what describes the reason for the suburb. I don't think that's true, and I'll tell you why. Also, there's a skepticism about any kind of hierarchy that goes together with that. Any kind of hierarchy. I believe that the city of Washington itself is a foreign phenomenon. It doesn't really belong in our country. It's not the way it was meant to be. It doesn't reflect the country that Benjamin Franklin wanted to have a turkey as a symbol of. What more properly reflects it are patterns of settlement like the one that's very close to us here in New Hampshire, the Canterbury Village. It's a wonderful place, and I take the students there often to learn about their roots because it reflects actually a very sort of unadulterated, pure version of what it is to be an American. A place where the buildings are not situated in relationship to one another. In fact, they carefully place them so that they never form centers. They never really form holes. The church itself is off to the side. where is it? There it is. So this individuality reflects itself in the kinds of buildings that we occupy. Have you ever been to New Hampshire or Maine and seen those little cottages by the road? Isn't that amazing? When you tour Europe, you never see anything like that. Why is it that when people in the United States go on vacation, they need to be in their own separate little house with its own separate little walls? Why is that? Is it libertarianism or is it something else? Also, this culture of wood, I just want to speculate about that. I've done this a lot in my course, just to immerse the students in what wood is, both as poetry and as pragmatism. And the pictures of wood buildings in New England, they're so powerful. They are truly the most beautiful and the most indigenous and the most transcendent evidence of our culture, these wooden buildings. This is the one that inspired the house that I showed you earlier. But look how wonderfully monumental they are, and at the same time ephemeral, because they're made of such light things. They're very modest in general. They don't aspire. It's only very late in the 18th century when buildings start to really aspire to something, when they have a second story even in the city. And also the interiors, how dominated they are by the wood that was being felled all around them. The wood was expressed, I suppose, because there was nothing to cover it with. But it became a part of who we are, that wood. And it's still here with us today. People are building timber homes, log homes. The first thing that you do is add wood trim, natural wood trim, to your house on the inside of it. And also starting to form urban aggregations. So, you know, this is the Vincent Scully part. The other thing about this wood architecture that is the temple of our civilization is how modest it is. These are extremely wealthy people that Richardson is, that Scully is documenting. Here's a Richardson Stoughton house just a few blocks away from us. Look how modest this building is. It's very quiet. It doesn't gesture. By the way, there are other types of architecture that were also doing similar things in terms of differentiation of elements, trying to express the space bubbling and exploding out, the roofiness of it, but in a totally different way. This is the English version, how different that is from the American version. And the modesty of materials also, right, of course. All derived, in the first instance, from post-medieval construction in England. This is our heritage, is post-medieval architecture, but combined, interestingly, with transportation. And isn't that an interesting connection? In the 17th and 18th century, the same carpenters that were building ships were building the houses. So from the very beginning, our architecture was about lightly touching on the land, it was about movement, and it was about ephemerality. It wasn't about digging in and making a place. It was always about lightly touching the land in relationship to the overwhelming wilderness that was all around us. So just keep in mind, these are the very same people building the houses. And that's where our technology ultimately comes from. Here's illustrating how we move around and how important that is to the architecture that we occupy, the light wood architecture that we occupy. One of my favorite Richardson houses, this is in Wareham, or Marion, Mass. Just shows you. I mean, these are wealthy people. They ask him to make a house. Look what he makes for them. It's barely there. The sequence of spaces on the inside, they're so casual in relationship to one another. There's no hierarchy, just like the Shaker village that I showed you earlier. There's a problem with this wood architecture. It's rustic. And here's the giant question that I want to pose to you. Can you make a city out of wood architecture? Is there something intrinsically antithetical to urbanity about the material itself? The material is irresistible for a number of reasons, and I'm going to demonstrate that to you in a minute, but this question of rusticity, I think, is paramount. How do you tame and civilize the rough-hewn wooden board and make it into a city? And so many architects, they trade on the rusticity of wood. That's not my interest. It's not in making cute wood buildings. This is good architecture. This is James Cutler in the Northwest, which has a wonderful tradition of wood architecture. What happens when you start to have to mass buildings together into cities because something has happened? Something huge has happened. A bomb went off in the early 19th century, and we had to put together those two things that don't go together, wood and cities. Time to go. Is it 7:45? A little past, okay. I'm nearing my conclusion. Here's the evidence of that wood architecture. and what used to be whole cities made of wood. And of course, what happened? They burned. They burned one after another, every place, all throughout the country. My thesis is very simple. We live in suburbs, maybe because we're libertarian, but we also live there because we have to. Because these buildings have to be kept away from one another. And there's two reasons that that's true. One reason is because of fire, which is a very important reason. The other reason is because we cannot aggregate wood buildings because they don't offer privacy. And we all today suffer in our wood architecture. We suffer terribly in ways that really are uncountable and immeasurable. I talk to my students all the time. I mean, they're constantly wrestling with people walking on them, making noise next door. Essentially, you can't put these wood buildings together. They don't work well as cities. Yet, there is a tremendous amount of land development ahead of us, and the amount of floor space that we demand is huge. This is the irresistibility of wood. Wood in this country makes buildings very cheap, much cheaper than they are anywhere else in the world. So that poses a dilemma for the architect, how to continue making wood, yet if we're all disagreed about what architecture consists of and how to bring a new consensus about what architecture should be, one thing that we're not disagreed about is what a city should be. No matter who you talk to, whatever studio you go into, you hear lessons about urbanity and density. We all know, and for the reasons that I talked about earlier, you need density in order to make a better future. I just wanted to show you examples of European architects who misread the problem of wood construction because it isn't the same for them as it is for us. So here's the city of wood. And it's interesting to think, well, this is Priene, a model of it, and I just wanted to show you that one of the enduring questions in my academic career has always been, what was all this? We don't know anything about it because it was made of mud. All that was left is this part, and we think that's Greek architecture, but what is all of this? And in fact, our cities aren't stealing glass at all. They actually are wood. And I'll put this another way. Here is the total volume of capital expenditure in our country, total volume. Now, we're so impressed by giant highways and tall buildings. The students are impressed, and they make projects around giant-scaled urbanities having to do with cities and concrete. This is what we actually spend our money on. Look at that pie. 53% of it is residential construction, and all of that is wood. A very tiny fraction of it is multifamily steel and glass apartment houses. This is the American architectural project. Now, you're saying architects aren't involved. I agree, we're not involved. That doesn't mean that it's not architecture. It's still architecture. Look how tiny these other fragments are. Things that we have come to respect, infrastructure, tiny fragment of even capital investment, all the things that people put into factories. Very small. This is what we really do as a country. We build houses. That is the national project. To put it another way, you can see the millions of units that are produced. This is an old map. And how much of it is private, detached, single-family housing on the bottom here. This is another chart that shows what's happened in terms of production, how uniform it is generally. This is by month, not by year. It's up in the 2 million unit area until recently, of course. And this is what it looks like. So I just made some maps of the cities that we live in. The purple is the wood city. So this city is a giant protoplasm of maybe 2-3 stories in high. Technically, it's 2.5 stories tall, according to the building codes, what you can do in wood. And at the center is the orange. That's the glass city that we know, the steel and glass city that we think of. Other examples, Charlotte, North Carolina. Chicago, you have this in the back of your head, but I'm just trying to make it much more clear and visible for you. Chicago, look at Chicago. And LA, of course. You can't even see the orange dot. That's the steel and glass part. The rest of this is the city. So I wish I had the figures, and I don't. There's no way to find them. Just, I would like to quantify the square foot area of all the wood construction in the country versus all the construction in non-combustible material in other places. So isn't wood unecological to use? So this question of cost and why it's so cheap, it just so happens that we have a lot more wood than we know what to do with. That's the long and short of it. I'm going to abbreviate this part, but this is a map of all the wood in the country. You can see where it is. It's actually in good places relative to where the population centers are, except for LA and Phoenix. So there's a lot of wood. It's very easy to get to, and it's very, very cheap. And this is just showing you what's happened to U.S. forest land. And most importantly, the supply is outgrowing the demand. Every year, there's more and more of a disparity between the amount of wood that's available and the amount of wood that's being used despite the little green tree on the hand dryer in the bathroom around the corner. This is the reality. Other projects have been tried in terms of what is the future of residential construction. None of them are as compelling as wood for the reason that I just showed you. I'm concerned about the arbitrariness of the city that we're living in. And if you want arbitrariness, this is just a symbol of the kind of arbitrariness that real estate as a way of thinking about making communities brings to the places that we live in, that we depend on for our well-being. Also, the problem of 20th century architecture, which I think is a very interesting problem. There's healing in the form of 20th century modernism, but there's also a lot of psychosis that has to do with identification with the agent of oppression, Stockholm syndrome. And I think we're in a moment just after industrialization where we're capable of moving behind that, beyond that, to a new kind of materiality. These are awful places. I mean, does anybody really think that's attractive as a place to live? That is not an image of a place that is supporting well-being. And, you know, I love this table, but it's made of steel and glass. I wouldn't want to put my hand on that. My point is that there are a lot of adaptations that we've made to the situation that we found ourselves in that it is time to outgrow. That, you know, industrial chic, I mean, these are terrible places. Elevators, garages. When I was talking about the uniformity of experience earlier, I really mean it. It's time to take stock. When we put somebody in a garage to go into a building, it's a mistake. It's a crime. Same with putting somebody in an elevator to go to a place that they need to work. They've become detached. This is not a good place. I'd like to rethink that. More examples of industrial chic and the results. The Holocaust, which is the epitome of the suffering that we've endured and that we're just recovering from. More industrial chic in the form of Charles and Ray Eames. But what is this building, really? It's that. It's Mies made, his first building was an electricity plant for IIT. That's really the identification of that architecture. The car is another problem. And I have huge news for you around the car, because we are all oppressed by cars. We think that they're demons, and they are. They've had a stranglehold on the places that we live for so long. Yet people love their cars. They need to have them. They need to have them on display and part of their house. Yet we end up with all of this. You know, this is just the most explicit version of what a car does to a place where people live. It takes over. It is the place where people live and not the people. Here's the news. The news is that cars no longer have to have a giant bustle on the front of them. They no longer are dangerous. And they no longer need to take up so much of our attention. Two things that are already in place that could be implemented today if we wanted to eliminate all of the roads and the byways that are dedicated to automobiles and change them over into places that are shared by people with, oh, by the way, cars as well. The proximity sensor, which any car nowadays has, which can tell you if you're about to hit a pedestrian or another car, and GPS, which can guide a car within inches along a route, a given route. So all of this infrastructure that we have today is really being called into jeopardy. And even the nature of the cars themselves, which are so resistant to being humanized, could be changed. Because now they're platforms, we can put houses on those, or rooms that can move around, that can be more like the architecture moving around rather than the houses adapting to the mobile device. Another problem of our time is the problem of anonymity, and most importantly, in the contemporary currency of architecture, the lack of sensory information on buildings in advanced architectural work, starting, of course, with the totalizing tendency of modernism. I think that children, if we just look again at psychology and what people start with, they crave sensory differentiation, different things. They need difference, and they need information, to be stimulated by information. So I'm worried about museums as paradigms. If we're looking at the people's history of architecture, I'm worried about museums. I think there is a place, probably, where museums have redounded to the benefit of ordinary people in those vast, countless numbers of hours that we actually live, and not just in the few hours where we go. But they're inherently deficient in terms of, you know, well, I picked this example just to show that I'm not ideological. I have no bias. But wouldn't this be improved if we could add something to it? Or, you know, once again, isn't it shocking that, I mean, we all know that this flower that was added probably wasn't the preference of the architect. Yet, even in this milieu, there was a need, a necessity, to add information. And I just have to tell you, this kind of architecture is ubiquitous now. And students are trying to replicate it and will be as they go out into practice. I think it's a terrible mistake because it's divorcing us further from the ability to engage. And one might say that buildings like this exist because of those automobiles that demand our attention and keep us away from pondering them, but that's all about to change. These are examples of environments that are full. I would imagine a new architecture that is full of differentiation, full of objecthood that is not just at one scale, but is at many scales in between. Remember, when we think of Rome, another story, I was there with a colleague who came here to teach briefly, and he talked a lot about, he taught me a lot about architectural invention, particularly about the double return stair and how it essentially was invented by Bramante and brought forward by Bramante from the helical stair. really fascinating insight about the importance of architectural invention and how it can transform the world. The idea of being able to start and return in the same place made such a big difference to the idea of density and creating multi-story buildings. But he showed me around, and he reminded me that all of these Roman palazzi of the Renaissance, they were covered with pictures of people. They were fully inhabited by evidence of scale, of occupation. And I think it's a kind of a city that we need to start thinking about again now that the cars may be going away, or at least having a different role, and people will be able to stand and walk around and actually occupy these places. Nature is a big question. Another problem of incompatibility with the city. We all desire boundlessness, and at the same time, the city prescribes boundedness because of the need for cellularization. So these are examples of boundlessness. In Schindler, this wonderful idea of bedroom, the most contained place, being the least contained on the roof of his house. Other imaginings of boundlessness that pop up, and ways of contending with it in mural painting, of course, which is really just an intent to take away the wall. Wallpaper here in Deerfield. And then finally, you know, this is really what we want. We want boundlessness. There is a tremendous super studio, for those of you who don't know it, but this is the ultimate American house. It's a place of without limit, without boundaries, and without closure. So how to achieve that and how to aggregate a city? So these, one thing that definitely will be happening very shortly is that displays like the one I'm looking at here and this one will become very cheap, like the paper that we write on. There will be an infinite possibility of boundlessness for every even enclosed room, which will change the nature of the city that we live in. So what are these giant changes that are about to take place? I'll go over them very briefly. You all probably know. When we were working at Andover at our Treasury Department headquarters for the Internal Revenue Service, we started with 1,800 employees. This is the building that we designed, which is now being completed. 1,800 employees. By the end, 6 years later, there are 3,000 employees. What's the difference? The difference isn't that they're being crammed into smaller space. The difference is that most of these people are working from home. The government is not a terribly liberal employer. This is happening all around the country. So you can imagine what this means for, this is the more of images of the IRS as it's coming, being completed. And the mini, it's like a luxury liner, all the different components of everyday life had to be built into it, from athletic facilities to food serveries there for them and so on. The most important thing about it was the wayfinding, and then this discovery that the building was being used by many more people than it was intended to be used by. So what does that mean for the city? I mean, this steel and glass city, we built it for people to work in. What if a third of those people aren't working there anymore? What's going to happen to that city? And where are they going? This is my important underlying sociological premise for the cities, the new city of wood, which is that people are going to be working from home a lot. There will be specialized moments when they will come together physically, and those will still remain important, but they will be smaller and smaller. Even a lot of the conferencing, well, the conferencing technology will continue to improve, so we won't even need that. The places where we'll need to come together are the places where there have to be random exchanges of information, not planned for or made appointments for, and that's a very important point. Also, this residential area, so where are they going? They're going back to their homes. What a really interesting phenomenon. It's a migration of people from the center of the city back out into that giant protoplasm that I described earlier, the one that was abandoned in the 50s when the women went off to work. This is what I meant by utilization. Those large areas aren't well utilized. Now they are. They're becoming more and more occupied as people start to work from home, and they will. They'll continue to, regardless of what Yahoo says, there are so many reasons why they will continue to. One, because modern life doesn't work, and this is a new opportunity to recast modern life. Two, because companies know it's a lot cheaper if they can get rid of a third of their real estate. And then three, because people are more productive at home. That's proven. It's well established. So these places where the women were and went away, they're going to be reoccupied. So residential architecture not only has a status in the national consciousness, but will have a new functional status in the way we live. And then there were the other things that you already know about, like shopping, which is leaving all these empty storefronts. Many of them have been filled by cell phones and by banks. How long will that last? It won't last for very long. And this trend, it's actually much more gentle than you would think. But it will continue. And there will be new ways. We've just learned that Amazon is now finding a way. One of the major impediments to internet shopping is that people don't like the gap between when they order something and when it's delivered. 2 or 3 days is too much. So Amazon is making places where you can order something in the morning and you can see it in the afternoon. And they're setting up these distribution facilities all over the country. Also, people are getting older. And what does that mean? It means that they're staying at home. They're not commuting. So this whole premise of, this is about materiality and how important it is to me. This whole premise of a commuter morphology of a city with a hardcore and people going to it and going back is being called into question. Much more likely that people will live in remote places where they'll be commuting for maybe 2 hours twice a week rather than 45 minutes every day. That's the future. I know actually quite a few people who are already doing that. Live in Vermont, they have jobs in Boston. They come in twice a week. The rest of the time, they're in Vermont. So you can imagine what that network of cities will be like. So this is a new opportunity for us to build a new kind of city. And one of the responses that we have to master is the response to the really appalling state of residential construction, which now we're going to be living in more. It's appalling. The houses that we live in are trash. They're made of asphalt that doesn't work very well. It doesn't even work functionally very well. It's cheap, yes, but it doesn't work. So life cycle cost doesn't really make sense. This is housing for wealthy people and poor people. It's not about money. It's about basically a culture of materiality that is deficient and not able to provide. You all know about it. Fortunately, in recent years, there has been a big change in the way we approach other aspects of our material culture. This is an automobile commercial from maybe 10 years ago. Some of you remember it. There's a guy that rolls a ball bearing down a joint of a hood in a car to demonstrate that the joint is perfect. Well, that trend is continuing. Everywhere that we look, this is a toaster from the 70s. I mean, really, look at that. Look what we were living with. And this is a toaster today. I mean, there's been a change, a remarkable change. And, of course, Apple. There's been a remarkable change in the way people invest themselves in the tangible evidence of material culture. Very marked change. There are correspondences in the way we eat, that's a very important one. I remember when I was young in this city, there were maybe 3 restaurants that you could go to, total. Also the way we buy food, how discriminating and discerning we are. Why did all of this bypass architecture? Why didn't architecture benefit from this change in culture? It's because I don't think we're doing enough to tell people what's possible. Organic food. I think the organic food movement is really an important precedent for us. Look at the fine discernments of difference people are making about their well-being in the food that they consume, and look at what they ignore in terms of the environments that they occupy. There's a huge contrast there that we need to be able to take advantage of. That kind of excellence, that's possible in wood. Also, individual control, and I won't go much into this. I love this Eileen Gray detail from her house. The identity that people have with their environments has to do with their control over their environments. It makes so much sense that she took from an airplane the nozzles that would direct air conditioning on her, and she could control that. In the same way that in our office buildings, like the one that we're building in Andover, we weren't able to implement this, but we should have. There's individual controls for every workstation. People need that. It's a must. It's not optional. Same with our houses. This was an error. Central heating is an error. People get cold. They get hot. They change all day long. They need a heat source to move back and forth to. You need to have that. We need to provide that to them. So here's my city, my new city of wood. It's based on prefabrication because not because prefabrication is cheaper. It isn't cheaper. The transportation and the redundancy make it similar in cost, but it makes possible a new level of quality that's similar to the kind of quality that is being delivered through other industrially designed products in a controlled environment where machines can be a part of the process. People have been dabbling with this for years. This is Gropius with Conrad Vachman from the late 30s trying to figure out how to manufacture housing off-site. Frank Lloyd Wright. But modular housing went in the wrong direction. Somehow it sold itself based on its cheapness, and really what it needed to do was talk about the controllability of it. So we've been working on this project for many years now. These are some of the earliest sketches. They're based on a house, three houses that were built that Scott referred to earlier in Brookline. And we're looking at modular boxes. A modular box is 14 feet wide. That's a good size for any residential space. It's fine. You can make connections between the boxes. You can make vertical connections sectionally. But 14 feet is fine, almost unlimited height. When you think about the tall things that get shipped on highways, and unlimited length. You think about the girders that you see on the highway. So this is the basic unit of aggregation. We explored this in a project for a university in Seattle, Washington. These are all stacked modular boxes. And I was trying to make the case that it wouldn't necessarily be cheaper, but it would be a much better quality of life for the students because, and this is another one that we did in Qatar, more evidence of the material possibilities of wood that go beyond rusticity. This is the school that I showed you earlier. And other experiments with wood construction in terms of paneling and especially in terms of luminous and transparent materials that can be placed in lieu of the plywood over the frame. The other big advance here has been the rain screen, which has been slow to be adopted, but will allow a much higher degree of refinement for architects. We don't have to clap things on and seal everything up with paint to make a viable wood building. Now we can do all of that behind and let the detailing happen in the front so that we can get, for example, windows and siding to be coplanar rather than having a giant piece of piping going around every element to close the gap. Another piece that's very important to me is in terms of the new material culture. One of the reasons buildings in wood seem so cheap is because they're clapped together out of planes. the Apple phone has a radius corner and it has weight. And I don't think that the plasticity is that we're looking for in the studio, for example, is really achievable in wood. People have tried. They've tried to scroll out a curved wood members, or they've tried to somehow bend things in the frame. The frame itself is fairly resistant to plasticity, but what's not resistant are the panels that go on them, which have a lot of plasticity. And it's a plasticity that's usually negative, but it could be made positive. It's just at a different scale than the whole building. And it's a kind of shapeliness that could give a new sense of tactile quality and sensibility of strength and worthiness to wood construction. Not only plywood, but also gypboard. So there's the frame that we need to deal with. And sadly, for the advocates of trying to understand the role of the computer in modeling the shape of architecture to come, trees come in straight lines. They just do. And we need to work with it. Now, you can spline them, definitely, but there's not much more than you can do than that to make shapely buildings, which I think are useful and important to make. It's just we need to make them within the vocabulary of the buildings that we're working with. So here are the possibilities of these modular boxes. These are drawings made by students in my office. These are legitimate modular boxes, 14 feet wide. They have one amazing characteristic that contemporary wood frame construction does not have. And here is the punchline to my story about the conflict between density and wood. You have fire and you have acoustics. Those are the two main problems. Acoustics. These modular boxes, they come separate. So there's redundancy built into them, and it comes free. You have redundancy between floors, and you have redundancy between walls. So you can have a perfectly acoustic separation, both horizontally and vertically. Now, if you could take that tool, what a difference it would make to creating a new density for a wood city. What a huge difference that would make. The other thing that these boxes can do is they can do gymnastics. They can't do plastic gymnastics, but they can pivot and swing and cantilever very easily because they're designed to span over two sets of wheels on a highway. So they have enormous structural capacity. So they can be pivoted on one another and they can project over one another. These are other buildings. This is the house that I mentioned earlier where we're experimenting with new forms of detailing to make architecture more urbane, wood architecture more urbane. And this is the rain screen and the idea of the plasticity at the local level. I'm not going to explain all the technical aspects of this. Another very important aspect of fault with wood construction is noise transmission from floor to floor and the sense of weightiness underfoot. I found that you can easily cast concrete on top of wood for the same structural capacity that the wood is normally designed for and also put the heat there. So in addition to the redundant floor construction, you add a little bit of concrete and you have your heat and you have mass, thermal mass, and also tactile mass. And then the occupation of roofs, which is so critical to getting at this question of boundlessness in the city, has to be addressed by wood construction as well. So green roofs with their thin soil and sleeper arrangements that allow the roof to pitch while the pavement and the green roof remain level and occupiable. And then finally, the kind of corners that you can start to develop using the bendability of the material, not trying to make the structure bend, but allowing the surfaces to bend. And then fire. I think the fire folks will tell you that no multiple people have ever died in a fire sprinkler building in the United States, including wood. So outside of 9/11, I suppose. Fire sprinkling is incredibly effective, and it's only a small fraction of the cost of a wood building if it's employed, and we still don't employ fire sprinkling. So all buildings should be fire sprinklered that are made of wood, and that would address the unconscious, collective unconscious paranoia about aggregating wood buildings close to one another into city groups. So I'm going to skip this section, which is about how to start thinking about making the plan of the city, and move directly into the kind of city that I have in mind. So Aldo Rossi, who was my teacher at Yale, he didn't say very much. He wasn't present very much. But what he did say, Cesar Pelli said we'd always remember him, and that it was the most important event in our lives. Maybe not the most important, but it was very important, even for the few words that he had to say for us. One of the things he said was that all of architecture, and this seemed so incredibly bombastic at the time, what a pompous thing to say, all of architecture was reducible to a point, a line, and a square. I think he's probably right about that. He is probably right. For all the typologists in the audience, this is the ultimate typology. And we made a city like that, or we started to think about that. The tower, the street, and the courtyard. And we started sketching on it and thinking about a kind of city that would not have the defects of a double-loaded corridor, that would not be infinitely extensible, that would not have the alienation that's created by the double-loaded corridor, which is a street, but that would have some of the attributes of a cul-de-sac, that would be navigable by GPS-controlled vehicles, and that would have a certain topology, that topography that would facilitate the occupation of very tall wood buildings like the ones that I've done in Brookline, which are 6 stories tall, which are the tallest wood buildings that I know of in this area. So 6 stories, that's a new kind of density for wood. And here's what one of those aggregations might look like. It has towers. It has pitched roofs. There will never be housing, a consensus around housing for the public and us unless there is pitched roofs. I'm sorry. It's a truth. Why is that? I'm not sure. I think it has to do with association and memory, which can't take that away. What's wrong with that? But I do think there's a new reason for pitch roofs, which is to collect sunlight. So you might have pitch roofs that collect sunlight and wind at the top of them, and at the same time that you're using the tower to disaggregate the density of the city at the upper levels, you're also creating light and view. You're making rooftop spaces for people to live in, and you're creating individual icons for individual houses, just at an upper level, not at the ground floor level. So the building split into 2 levels. Here's the back of it. This is the street side. And we have to model the ground in the same way that the Back Bay and the South End are in order to make use of these. People are now living in 6-foot-story houses all the time, all throughout the Back Bay and the South End. They do it because that's just the way people live. It makes a lot of sense to live like that. But you have to carve away the earth so that you're entering at a midpoint in the section and not just at the bottom. Other things that I'm thinking about are what the car will become. Instead of garages, why not have cars without the massive mechanical things that have to be attached to them? Why not have cars that are really like rooms in the house that are just detachable so that people can show off their cars in the front of their house but not have a garage, which takes up so much space with all the move-around space around it, right out in front of them. This is what that looks like in plan. And then we looked at several ways of aggregating this into, what should I call them? Yeah, the the new cities of wood, which are really towns of wood, which would be not clustered into massive configurations that people commute to centrally, but are disaggregated all across the countryside in thinly connected networks, probably near metropolitan areas, but within a two-hour radius or a three-hour radius, where people live and work. They live and work so that the houses have rooms in them that are offices. They have to have places to work and to be to concentrate and to meditate. So this is one that we did on a hillside. Another that we did, we call that the hill town. The windbreak town in the Midwest, one on a wide open plain that's more about the precious resource of nature. Each one of these is a place made by a differentiating moment in nature, a hill, a windbreak, or a valley. Valley Brook, a rendering of what the windbreak town might look like. The Valley Brook town. These are all sizes of buildings that at four stories are being done commonplace all around where we live today. They're just being densified by going higher and being brought closer together. That looks like. And then to radicalize this and to provide a provocation, thinking about the reoccupation of the city. And instead of thinking about urbanizing the suburbs, thinking about suburbanizing the city, colonizing the city with a kind of environment that Americans crave, a place that's close to nature, where there's individuation, where there's acoustic privacy, safe from fire, and where the open spaces are suffused throughout, not ghettoized into parks. What is a park? A park is a very poor excuse for what the city can't provide. It's really an admission that the city is deficient. It's saying everything around you is bad. You need a place of refuge to go to get away from that. So let's make the park around everywhere, all around the buildings, all around everyone's everyday life, instead of a place, a destination to go to. And we thought about City Hall and the terrible problem of City Hall that keeps gnawing at all of us, and how the building might look better if it were crowded. This is Mantua, San Andrea, and Mantua by Alberti, which I went to, and I remember the first impression I had, where is the cathedral? Where is it? You know, it's buried. Why didn't they make a piazza in front of it or some open space around it so that we could see it? But how much better it is that it's buried as a void space in the middle of the city. So we started to think of City Hall Plaza and how to reoccupy it. And instead of the mayor bringing the City Hall out into the neighborhoods, let's bring a neighborhood to the City Hall and reoccupy these places, these barren, uninhabited places throughout the city. Let's put housing there. Why not? And it could be wood housing, easily could be wood housing, according to the principles that I've addressed earlier. This is something of what that would look like with the derelict 20th century city rotting in the background and the new wood architecture all around us with all of its figuration and all of its visual interest to stimulate and give people a sense of well-being, and the towers, which signify the individual families that occupy them, and the courtyards, which provide a place of clustering, a smaller scale for a local community. So, in sum, what is happening, I think, is that the workplace is changing dramatically. The old map of the city that we know today, it's obsolete. It won't survive. Even another 5 or 10 years, it won't survive. Mobility is increasingly virtual. Commuting is increasingly virtual. Commerce is increasingly virtual. There is a real possibility that the separated workplace, dwelling, and commercial concentrations that have, in the last 50 years, driven the The emptying of streets will someday become obsolete. There is a possibility that housing will not just be mostly the stuff of cities, but all of cities. Housing will be the whole city. Then, in the post-vehicular city, we will see what streets will become. It will not be a city without cars, nor a restoration of quaint pedestrianism, but a place where cars have a new and less fearsomely essential value. In their carefully scaled streets and cleverly configured courtyards, these new cities will seek to heal the empty places of today's cities and offer a view of a transformative importance of housing for the future, a future where, perhaps, dwellings will once again be fully occupied throughout the day, and where streets will not just be conduits, but are themselves livable and lived-in gardens. Thank you. Oh, I'm sorry that ran over. Probably you're exhausted and there's no room for questions, but Scott, a question? Yes? The essential provocateur, yes, please.
I have a comment for you, Jonathan.
Let Antoine do that, yes.
A comment, yes.
So far I thought you were the voice of wisdom and I had not realized, you know, the fabulous utopian you can be. So thank you.
That's a different kind of wisdom. Over here.
Have you noticed the new rental apartments on the bottom of Route 2 as you come into Cambridge?
Yes.
Off to the right?
Yes, I have, yes.
And how that was built?
Yes, in wood, yes.
I guess it's over 200 units.
Mm-hmm.
In rental. So what I heard from a developer is that they're sort of cashing in on the rental units, but that
badly, yes. That's not a good prescription for the city. No.
It's kind of a horrible location because they haven't really linked it to Alewife particularly well.
Do you have a question?
I see a lot of that as sort of a vernacular that they're kind of arriving
at. It is. It's all around us, but it hasn't yet been codified, and it hasn't yet been thought of as a city. So what we're seeing is random, high-density wood developments. You see them all on the major thoroughfares, mostly around the city, going out Route 93. But unfortunately, they don't cohere as a way of living, and that's a big problem because no one's thought about it. Because we're not thinking about it. Yes, in the back.
You talked about a lot about wood as construction, as material, and you showed some of examples of Europe and the building of construction there used as a material. My question to you is, you show a couple maps where United States is shown and the cities, the percentage of wood used in those cities is small if you compare it to the expansion of the land. But most of the wood that it's used for construction in the United States does not come from the United States.
Oh, that's not true. No,
that's most
not
of
true.
The wood?
A lot of it comes from Canada, but you mean Canada?
Yeah, but if you just look at United States, Canada is not United States. Canada is Canada.
Okay, I should have used the word North American.
Still,
I'm willing to accept that, North American.
Right, but if you look at the map, I mean, most of the wood does not come from here, so how do you compare?
No, that's not true. I don't think that's true. There's a lot of locally sourced wood that's coming right to your lumber yard right here. Pine, spur, and fir, and spruce. It's coming right from Maine, right to where we are.
All right.
And also in the southeast, it's huge. I mean, Georgia Pacific is a southeast company. It's not a Canadian company.
Right. But my question is, if you continue the productivity of wood, of using the wood as a material for this type of housing, how do you expect to increase the productivity, the rapid growth of wood as this equals
you
the
have construction? I'll tell you in a nutshell, but you have to visit and do the research yourself. The reality is, no matter how much we build, we will not catch up to the amount of wood that's available for us to use. There's no way. There's far more timber available to be harvested than we can use, and that's not even taking into account the fact that timber is a renewable resource. It's farmed. So you use the wood, you farm it, and you use more of it. That's not true. Many people wish, but that's not really true. No, and I had another map, but I won't. You can do the research yourself. Yep. Okay, Matt.
Thank you very much. Your massings are very interesting, and I was wondering if you could talk about the massings of your housings that you showed at the end. They seem to depict a tension between the individual and the collective. I wonder if you could elaborate on that.
Yeah, well, I didn't really expound on that, but there's actually six different types of massings. They relate to the elevations. Essentially, there's a street and a courtyard type of massing. The street one is more suppressed and having to do with frontality and entrance. The courtyard one is more about objecthood and the space of the courtyard. Those are then permutated with the two different orientations of north and south. Actually three, north, south, and then east, west. So that's what produces the variety that you're seeing in the renderings. It's the six different types of elevations produced by permutating street and court versus the three solar orientations. Individuality, yes. I don't think people in the United States like to live collectively. I just don't. If you're living in an apartment building, you think it's a stage to living in your own house someday. That's the reality. So we're trying to create a kind of a density that allows for people to have a sense of individuality. You can do that in row houses, but not very effectively. That's why I believe that the tower, helps create the objecthood of the house, which is so important to people. I think it's gotten very late, and I know we could do this more. Scott, do you agree? Yes, I know you do. So I want to thank you once again, and thank you for your patience. Okay, bye-bye.